Hey folks, Quillotine here, and welcome to the GOG.com live stream featuring Europa Universalis 1. That is right! We are going old school today with one of the, the first product from Paradox Development Studios, more or less. Europa Universalis, the thing that started it all. This game is about 14 years old. It was just added to the GOG.com catalog today, along with the original CK, Crusader Kings, and Hearts of Iron, for example, as well as a handful of other products. I'm sure the GOG people will be throwing some links down below. Joining me today will be a very special guest, Johan Andersson. I'll get him on Skype in just a second. Before I get there, I do want to note that you could be watching this on twitch.tv/gogcom, or you could be watching it on twitch.tv/quill18. Do keep in mind there will be some giveaways going on throughout this live stream. I believe it'll be on the gogcom channel. So if you're watching the quill18 channel, that is perfectly fine. But make sure to check the other one just to make sure that you don't miss any of the giveaways. Looks like everything is coming through okay. Hopefully all the volume is good. Everyone seems to be pretty happy out there. Excellent. Of course, if you haven't done so already, make sure to follow twitch.tv/gogcom, twitch.tv/quillotine, and you can check me out on YouTube at youtube.com/quillotine. Let me go have a ring to Johan Andersson. Johan Andersson is the lead designer for EU and, well, lots of other things at Paradox, actually. Hopefully that will come through okay. Let me turn the music off a little bit more. Hello, hello! Johan, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. How are you doing?
Excellent, I'm doing great.
Yeah.
I left beautiful Sweden just a couple of days ago, and now here we are talking again.
Yeah, it felt like yesterday we were at that weird bunker.
Yeah, the World War II bunker in Stockholm.
Yeah, the former, I thought it was the Marine Command in World War II. Can't remember exact details.
Someone told me that underneath the room we were in, there were actually space for submarines. Like, they had water access and they were parking submarines in there.
Yeah. Sounds likely, because it was on the shipping island where lots of naval stuff has been through the years.
Wow. Well, why don't you explain one more time to everyone in the chat exactly who you are, why you're important, especially in this EU type of setting?
I'm Johan, last name Andersson. I've been working with computer games for close to 21 years now, most of them at Paradox as designer, programmer, producer, executive, etc. And Europa Universalis is the series I've been with from the earliest beginning.
And you've been working on the series throughout, haven't you?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I started at the company when it was like the game was supposed to start.
Now, this was originally like a licensed product, wasn't it? Based on a board game?
Yeah, it was started in 95. 95 was the ideas. 97, in the autumn, the project started, and in January 98, I started working on it. So I've been there from the start. And it was basically, it was a board game in, that was published in the early 90s. It was a French board game by Philippe Thibault, and it was lots of cool ideas, but it was kind of unplayable. And the board game took like 1,000 hours to play through, and you needed 6 players, and you basically needed Excel sheets for each turn.
Wow. Yeah, there's still a few of those today, but they don't tend to get very popular.
No, it was not really playable.
Was it called Europa Universalis, or did it have another name?
Yeah, that was the name of the board game. You could probably Google it, and you'll find some copies of it. And and basically, it was these guys in Sweden who had a history of doing board games for a company called Target Games that thought, well, this board game looks really, really interesting, but it's not playable, but we would love to play a computer game on it. And then they thought, And we thought, how do we do it? Well, if we make it a real time and have the entire world instead of just a European map and a North American map, you'll basically be able to play all the world and all the countries. And yeah.
Just have to excuse myself on the stream here. With these games that run full screen, I like to run them in a virtual machine to make it easier to tab in and out. But apparently the game did not like that. Funny thing with games that came out 14 years ago, they did not like to be tabbed.
No, it's kind of awkward there. And I think, like, when we're running the development, to actually have it run in... because it's running on a 16-bit surface, if I recall correctly.
Really?
Yeah, it was... This was basically before the three-dimensional cards were done, so everything is 2D. It's actually, there's a lot in the graphic routines that are written in pure assembler, if I remember correctly.
I've been programming for a really long time, and I remember having to do that. Now, this was a Windows title, but was it before DirectX became a big thing?
No, DirectX was big.
Okay.
A few years earlier, I was like, I think this was DirectX 3. It required, or was it 5? It's 15 years, so can't remember which version number it required.
So when I made a post about this, a lot of people were asking me what the difference between EU and EU4 were, and I think there are a lot. Like, I think if you compared it to EU2 or EU3, there are fewer differences. You know, you've got your sliders for your economy.
Well, EU1 is like the baseline. It had like provinces, it had units, and you had colonists and merchants and so. But there were some differences. It was like you had basically no customization on countries. You had none of the like ideas, historical events, nothing like that.
Were there no events at all?
And there were 50 different random events.
Okay. Now, was it EU2 that people said was a little bit more, predefined and linear, what would happen?
Yeah, well,
more
that's
historical.
A little bit like people remembering stuff, because we had like 800 historical events or 900 something for EU2 at release. The interesting aspect is that EU4 shipped with far more than EU2 had, and for more countries. But people seem to think that EU2 was railroaded.
Are you saying that people only remember what they want to remember on the internet?
Yeah, it's a little bit like that. But there's also people, there's a lot of people that played EU2 that went for a user mod, or actually was an amalgamation of two user mods that was originally the AGC. And the EEP. AGC was Alternative Grand Campaign, and EEP was Extended Events Project. It was two large mods, and then emerged after a few years, and they had like thousands upon thousands of events. So a lot of people that played EU2 for a lot of years before the third installment of the series, they remember playing that mod, which meant that probably skewed their opinion of how the game was.
Okay, so this mod was actually really widespread then?
Yeah, at least on the forums. But back in those days, games didn't really have metrics, so you couldn't really track how many people played, and so the only metrics you had was basically reports from various sales partners of like how much they had sold, which had like not much knowledge or actual data. And then we had how many people that downloaded, because we had web trackers, like how many people downloaded certain amounts of patches from, and each patches were localized for different regions as well, so that's how we could track a little bit.
Did you have any digital distribution at that time or not?
No, there was no digital before like 2007 or so.
I actually have a physical copy of EU1 on my desk right here. I played it for about 10 minutes, and that was about it, all I could handle at the time. But...
Oh, I think I have, like, before I moved the last time, I used to have a box where I'd taken a copy of, like, every single version of EU1 and EU2. And now I don't have the Twitch chat, but you could ask if there's anyone, or if there's anyone there that are Polish and bought the original EU1, if they remember the huge box. It was a huge, huge box, like, you know how boxes were back in the old days? Like,
yeah.
Big, but the one in Poland were like twice as big, and there was still just a little CD inside.
Oh, was the, like, box so big? Was it just a bigger manual, or just looked better on the shelf?
Really, I can't remember. I never really opened them. I just kept them all for the different versions, just because I wanted to have them all. But now I didn't keep them after they moved, like 5 years ago. So.
The mods that you're talking about, did you have any actual official mod support in the game, or was it just people were kind of overwriting text files?
We just had text files.
Yeah.
One interesting thing is, like, there was an EU1 mod called IGC, Independent Grand Campaign, which was basically done by a German guy. I can't remember his name, but he basically disappeared off the forum, together with a Swedish guy who really liked modding. He had a forum nickname called Doom Dark. And that guy, he also had his real name was Henrik Foreus. And Henrik was really, really interested in these things. So I thought, like, well, do you want to be hired and do some events files for EU2? And he did that. And then he started working on some design. And you met him a few times, actually.
Of course.
Yes. He's the Crusader Kings lead designer and an industry veteran with, like, 15 years of game design these days.
He started that guy knows as a moderator. So much history. It's unbelievable.
that's kind of funny. There's a lot of people that started in the industry as modders on our games.
Well, Wiz is a great example of that, like, as a more recent thing.
Yeah, he's been doing it since EU Rome, I think. There's another guy, an American guy, who's making his indie games these days, but he started as a modder on Hearts of Iron 1, John Schaefer.
I know John Schaefer. I didn't know he started as a modder.
Yeah, he was a modder. He modded the AI for Hearts of Iron 1 like 12, 13 years ago. So there's a lot of people that start in industry by modding and then cutting their teeth there and getting their foot into the industry as developers.
Right. Well, then I know that the same thing happens in like the first-person shooter world, everything like that. Because I think what it does is it proves, two things: that you're kind of smart enough to figure it out. You're also generally like a hard worker and a creative person. Like, it takes a lot of effort to put together and maintain a mod, and that's exactly the sort of people, you know, companies would want to hire.
Yeah, most of them. Sometimes mod makers, there's a big problem as a mod maker because you, they're so easy to get the kitchen sink mentality. You have to get everything in.
Right.
Yeah, and then you want to keep adding and keep adding. It's the most successful modders are the ones that know when to remove things. Because it's like removing... a design is finished when there's nothing else to remove.
Yeah, but they say that about... what is it, sculpture? Like, it's an art quote that I'm used to hearing about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, perfection is attained.
Yeah, it's simplifying stuff. It becomes more elegant. It's easier to look some, see connections between things.
Now I noticed a lot of the game mechanics are actually still in from way back when. You've got attrition. You've got maneuver, fire, and shock for your combat mechanics. Are those all derived from the board games and just decided to keep them around because they work and they're familiar?
Yep. One thing that a lot of people may not be aware of is that have you played now EU1 a little bit and looked at it? The siege mechanic has not changed since EU1. The only thing that people think it's completely new in EU4 is that we actually exposed the interface.
Really? So all the dice rolls for sieging, The taking down the walls. What about blockading? Is that in there too?
Yeah. Actually, in EU4, it used to be that two ships or one ship, or I can't remember, was enough to blockade any port. Of course, in EU4 now, it depends on how many guns and speed and whatever it is compared to base stacks. But back in those days, it was one ship blockaded everything it was adjacent to.
Oh, just one ship. Yeah, because now you need different numbers, which I think makes a lot more sense.
Yeah.
I've just declared war in the Teutonic Order here. We'll see how it goes.
Oh, so what you're playing?
I put out a straw poll to see what people would like me to do. And I guess because it's a GOG.com stream and they are in Poland, playing as Poland-Lithuania.
Oh, that's cool.
Now, one thing, when you start EU, you couldn't pick just any country. You have to pick from the list of 8 suggested ones, or am I wrong?
Yeah. Yeah, there was only 8 suggested in each scenario. And that was one of the things that why they started the first mod, because they started mods which let you play other countries.
Ah, right. By EU2, could you play anything?
Yeah. And then we basically... Oh, God. EU2 was... I don't know how we got away with calling it a sequel, because basically it was like four months basically of programming time for me, 1 month of designing for me, two and a half months of events from Henrik. We had a little bit of art, and then we released it as a sequel.
Wow.
But we needed the cash back in those days. The original E1 was not profitable. Cost a lot of money to develop.
Did it really? How many programmers did you have on the team at the time?
Oh, God, from the start, I think at most we were like 5 or 6 programmers, 2 or 3 artists. The actual map code, we took like huge bitmaps, and the map was all was like crunched into some sort of tile-based system. It took like 8 hours to process the map down to, like, instead of costing like 1 gigabyte, which was insane memory then, it cost like 30 megabytes maybe in the memory. But it was impossible to edit. So basically you had to draw it in a machine with enormous amount of memory and swap space and so, and then crunch it down for hours. That's part of why the map were not really always the best.
Some people say, now I don't know if this is true, but that they say that the original EU focused primarily on Europe specifically and didn't really put much attention on the rest of the world.
Yeah.
I mean, it's right there in the name, so it sort of makes sense.
Yeah,
it certainly could have started from Eastern Power.
No, it was basically straight port of the board game. There was about like 10 countries outside of Europe, like 2 or 3 in India. You had like China, Japan, Aztecs, Inca, Iroquois, I think, or something. Or actually, yeah, it was called Ohio, that country in the code from the design. I don't remember why, but it's kind of weird. So it was not really any focused and was super European biased.
Was Sweden OP?
You couldn't play Sweden in the original Grand Prix. Right.
None of the bookmarks had Sweden?
I think it was like one bookmark had Sweden, but let's face it, that's one of the stupidest things we've done for the years, is developing other scenarios than Grand Campaigns. Since we started having metrics, realized it's like 99% of all starter games are Grand Campaigns.
Yeah, I remember you mentioning that during our live stream at PDXCon when we were looking at some of the other bookmarks. And it's true. I haven't played anything else other than maybe one to sample something specific,
like
the Rebellions.
Yeah, we're not going to develop more scenarios for future games. Of course, Archfire needs 2 scenarios because some people just want to jump into the war. But it's like if we do an EU5 or when we do Rome 2 and when we do Victoria 3, we're just going to have one starting scenario, nothing else.
Really? Are you still going to have the ability to toggle the time at all, or it's just going to...
No, toggling time, no, nothing like that. Because that's just enormous amount of job that nobody uses and it costs pain for... It's just too costly and basically nobody enjoys it. It's better to have... Instead of... Let's face it, if we had made a game like EU4 and... Instead of maintaining and all this history stuff, we could have had supported 40 more countries, or every country could have like a national ideas and at the start when we released the game instead.
Right.
And that people would have loved that more. More people would have enjoyed it.
Yeah, you've been able to fill in a lot of those national ideas with expansions, but
yeah,
it would have been there early on.
Yeah.
I'm going to try to tab out of the game here because the volume is not being adjusted, and every time I go into a fight, I think everyone is being deafened.
Oh, God.
Well, old games and ports on new computers, it's the way it goes.
Now I just remember how the actual combat sound was that the art was like, he was an interface and sound program called Shialalich, and he was... basically coding the various combat sequence things. I think there's like four different sound effects we had in total for combat, but they were very short, but he coded a large sequencer inside the code so that the combat sound doesn't loop that much. It just basically tries to play a bunch of... It was kind of interesting.
Really? So, okay, this is... So they're not like sound waves or something.
No, it's four or five. It's like two different cannons, one or two different sword clangs, and there's like some background stuff, and they keep playing in multiple channels and mixing. And there's, yeah, it was kind of interesting code that was done, but. The original EU1, we were a bunch of people that had been working on 16-bit consoles. We knew about memory constraints. We knew about all those things. So underneath the hood in all this technical stuff in EU1 were really, really good. The guy who wrote the map code for EU1, his name is Linus Blomberg. After EU1, we were working in EU2, he and a producer at Paradox those days, they left to form their own development studio. And he's now currently the CTO, technical director of his own studio called Avalanche. And he's the guy behind Just Cause, all the technology there.
Oh, really?
So that's... So there's a lot of... There was a lot of interesting characters... also, the guy that wrote the original AI for EO1, he left and moved to the US after EO1 and ended up working for a lot of studios and is currently one of the senior engine developer at Epic. So,
well, yeah, I was going to actually ask you about the AI in the game, because obviously in any sort of strategy game, AI's got to be tough. Because it's got to be decision-making, it's got to do all that. And, you know, how sophisticated was the AI way back when?
Too fucking too sophisticated for its own good. We had all this, like, agent system and resource management and so on, and different notification systems between others and so on. It was basically a super nice system that cost 6 months to develop and super great, but... it didn't really play the game all that great.
Yeah, I actually got a chance to talk to, I think it was Wiz that we were talking about the AI. I mean, it must have been Wiz for EU4. And it was really interesting finding out that there's actually like different sort of AI brains that get attached to different armies. Like a large army will have a different and more sophisticated AI brain than a small one, because if everything had the big AI brain, it would bring a system to a crawl. And when this was being developed, I mean, the processing power was so much less. So you must have had to like really work hard to get a system that's performant.
You know, the interesting thing is, like, at the time during E1, the armies didn't really have any advanced evaluation logic of where to move. Whenever we tried to add more rules, it just made behavior worse. It was basically a large part of, like, the decision making was just random and rolling on base tax dice.
Oh, really? That's what the AI was. It was semi-random.
Everything is using dice rolls everywhere, but the decision making was rolling a dice.
Wow. I mean, you always have to have a bit of a random factor in there to try to, you know, just make it so that it's not completely deterministic. But yeah, well, what else are you gonna do?
That's one of the internal jokes we have. If you look at when was we released Victorian Revolutions, 2007, 2006, can't remember. We had this like capitalist AI where the AI was building factories for you. There was this large threads where people were like discussing how to manipulate the AI and what the AI looked at before creating the factories, etc. And then we were doing the sequel, Victoria 2, and we had much more advanced AI than we had in Victoria 1. People were complaining that, oh, can't you just copy the Victoria 1 AI? The Victoria AI was superbly great, and the new one is completely a failure. Can you guess what the difference between Victoria 1 and Victoria 2 was?
In 2, you had actual AI as opposed to random dice rolls?
Yeah, in Victoria 1, the factory built was was basically a dice roll that was just weighted on, did I have this factory or not? Just complete random. While in Victoria 2, it actually looked at what was needed, what was profitable, what was best for investments, what did have access to raw materials and so on. But it's always in the suspension of disbelief.
Yeah. Well, I've heard it applied to the same thing for like first-person shooters where you're fighting against bots and things. Bots that just decide to dodge completely randomly felt more realistic than ones who are trying to move more rationally and reasonably, which is kind of nuts. I had Crimea declare war on me here, so I'm going to have to finish up my war with the Teutonic Order before I can go and clean them up.
Yeah. Yeah, that's, if I recall correctly, now it's like 15 years since I saw EU1 lost. The peace negotiation is really, really different in EU1.
Yeah.
Because you can only take a few provinces. You can only annex if they have one province left.
Basically, it seems like the game kind of decides what you're allowed to ask for.
Yeah, and it's very, very different things you can... The diplomatic system is so limited in EU1.
Yeah, well, I noticed I couldn't even ask for military access. I did a little test game as France, and I was trying to get to Milan, and I couldn't because it's not something you can ask for.
No, that's... if I recall correctly, we added that in EU2.
And from alliance, I'm just looking at different options. You did have offer vassalization and annexing, which is pretty interesting.
Yeah, in the original board game, it was a track where you had like a neutral, royal marriage, vassalization, and then annexation for a diplomatic integration track, and it's still kind of like the same in EU4 back. Currently, even if we have diverged like vassals into so many different things these days, with marches and client states and protectorates and trade companies and God.
I still haven't built a client state yet. For whatever reason, I just haven't had a game go in that direction, so I have zero experience with it. And I'm so sad because it sounded really cool.
Yeah, it's cool to just create your own country.
Mm-hmm.
As a vassal, and when you don't want to bother, when you don't have cores, you can't core enough, etc. It's a good vassal feeding tool in the last 100 years when you gobble up the world.
Every now and again, I'm getting a little bit of, I think, scratching sounds, and maybe the mic's being bumped. Hoping we're not deafening anyone on the other side.
I'm sorry.
What was I gonna say? One thing that I keep seeing in EU is this pop-up where I guess it's like I'm not playing as the ruler or something like that, because the ruler keeps giving me titles, you know, brings me up to being a baron or this or that, and says I can be called my lord. That's kind of, that is different.
Yeah, that's something that we kind of scrapped off the EU one. I also had this got from fulfilling missions.
Right, the mission system in here is different because you can have like multiple current missions going on at the same time.
Yeah.
I mean, I've always liked the mission system in these games because it sort of gives you a hint as to what you might want to do, for example. It's a suggestion as like, well, this might be a good idea. Have you tried that?
Yeah.
And it's just bringing it up to the next level. In fact, the king was even giving me missions automatically. So did that have any gameplay function at all? The fact that you had kind of a personal title, or is it just cosmetic?
It was just cosmetic. It's like, we really didn't know when we were designing this game. It's like, what type of goals can you have? How do you win? Etc. We just tried a lot of different things.
Well, I can't imagine all the stuff you're talking about being in a board game. It must have been incredibly tedious to play.
Oh, yeah. I've never really played a board game.
I'm a big fan of complicated board games, but yeah, that sounds a little over the top. I know there's another current board game. I think it's called, like, is it Twilight Imperium? I might be thinking of a different one. It's a space-based one, but you have to sit down for something like 10 hours to try to play it. It's basically, it sounds like EU in space.
Oh, yeah. I've played board games for longer. Back in the old days when I was single and in my early 20s, where we were doing the Advanced Civilization weekend marathons. Have you ever played that board game?
No, I haven't.
It's the game that inspired the Civilization series. It's arguably the best board game and most fun of all times. Look it up, and the Imperial variant with expanded maps are so fun.
Is it called Advanced Civilization, you said?
Yep. The original was Civilization in like late 70s, early 80s. And then the rule redesign was called Advanced Civilization, Avalon Hill. Late 80s, mid 80s, late 80s.
Avalon Hill, I know. They've made a lot of really good stuff. Big fan of their products. Well, I mean, they published like hundreds of board games, it feels like. So I guess they have to have something that's good.
Yeah.
So, to people who aren't used to anything before EU4, the idea of these sort of economic sliders might be new to them. Those have been like a staple for a really, really long time, and EU4 did away with them in exchange more for kind of monarch points. Although there was a little bit of a precursor to things like monarch points in that diplomats, settlers, and merchants were things you expended, like you use them as a currency. They were spent, and then you had to wait for them to recharge. What was your decision for, like, ultimately doing away with those sliders in 4?
Because there were this, what's it called, snowball effects, hard to balance between small countries and big countries. It was just horrendously imbalanced in the long run. And it just didn't create any fun games. Well, obviously they were fun in those days, but it's like have a mechanic that worked. It was so hard to have everything tied to the economy, and it just didn't feel right.
Yeah, no, and it's true. Like, it's weird that you're spending money via to go to research or to go to stability. Plus, I have to say, I'm quite a fan of the fact that with the current monarch points, you make very big and explicit decisions. When you push a button to increase stability, that is a very kind of willful plan that you're putting into effect. All right, I think I finished my siege, but I can't figure out why I can't get the Teutonic Order to just give up here.
Yeah, that was one of the bad things with the old AI, and that they were too stubborn, and you had no clue of why they are stubborn. Because there's no interface, there's no feedback.
Yeah, there's not even a relationship meter, is there?
No. Well, there's an opinion, or not opinion, but there's a relation value between the countries.
Oh, there it is.
But the peace negotiation is like opaque at its best.
Yep. And I see what the problem is. They have a vassal, I think. I mean, the game did a lot. Like, there was nothing else like this when this came out. It was absolutely incredible. All right. This is really interesting. Curland is a vassal of the Teutonic Order. They're not actually in the war.
No, vassals didn't have to be allied back in the days.
That's so weird. Well, at least now in hindsight. Now, EU4, you went EU to EU2, and then you did Hearts of Iron, or is that not the order? I can't remember exactly.
EU2. Now I'm just going by memory, because I'm an old guy these days. Might be foggy. I should go to retirement home. So, it was EU1, EU2, Hearts of Iron 1. Was it Victoria? CK, Hearts of Iron 2, Hearts of Iron 2 Doomsday, Diplomacy, EU3, I think, then Rome, then Hearts of Iron 3, then Victoria 2, then Sengoku.
Oh, I've never played. That's the one that's CK2, but in Japan, yeah?
Yeah, it's very simple compared to it. But it was the one where which had a like plotting system, and you conquered stuff immediately. It was kind of fun. It was long-term a little bit shallow. And we also had a problem with people not getting attached. It's like, let's face it, the average American or European could probably tell you like 10 European countries, or if you're a strategy game, like, you know the difference, you know there's a thing called Spain, you know there's a thing called Portugal, you know there's a thing called Poland, even if you have no history, because you've heard those names quite a lot for time.
Right.
But Japanese clans, trick question, how many can you name?
None at all.
Yeah.
And even, in EU4, you start off, you've got the one province or two province Japan, and then all these third-party provinces, and I don't know what they are.
No, it's like, I knew about Nobunaga before it started, and that's like, yes, that's about the limit of my knowledge when we started. Of course, we learned a lot while designing it, and Japanese history is fascinating, as a lot of people know, but the average consumer have in the Western world, for them, it's just another name.
Yeah. That's one of the reasons that at first when the nation designer for EU4 was announced, I was like, I don't know. And like the sort of randomized nation mix-up, I was like, I don't know. It's going to be kind of weird playing with something non-standard. Although I think it's going to be pretty awesome to make crazy, crazy nations in practice. I'm going to, of course, make my Belgium. That's key. I'm probably going to put it in Africa.
Yeah.
You know, as you do.
Oh. Yeah, I did a superb mistake and got eliminated in we did a multiplayer campaign in today's testing, and we tested the nation designer again, and I created my El Toro, because it's an internal joke, because of a war over Roussillon and the Spanish conquering it and renaming it. And so anyway, so I named a country called El Toro, oriented around southern France, northern Spain, and it was a Norse merchant republic, and with some military ideas and pretty decent size, like about twice as big as Aragon. I only have the problem is that Norse is a pagan country.
Right.
And the rest of Europe is not pagan.
No, so politically you're kind of screwed.
Yeah, so there was like three different countries nearby that allied and rivaled me and attacked me day one and destroyed me. And they the AI. It's like, yes, going Norse in the middle of Central Europe, not a good idea.
Now, I noticed a couple of times, yeah, you going into the Nation Designer and picking Norse. What's the what appeals to you about that? Because obviously that's not something that's in the normal game.
No, it's like what we added there. And the thing with Norse and their combination with republics was and min max thing is like republic, you get new rulers. And the Norse, I don't know if you played the Crusader King, it's the same mechanic as the Crusader Kings 2 exporter, is that the Norse have, every time you have a new ruler, you can select a new patron god.
Right.
It's kind of like the Hindu. And you have different gods, so it's like, okay, I want to focus on war. And since you can re-elect all the time in a republic every 4 years, you have complete control over which two powerful bonuses you want. And the base Norse is like some, what's the land force limits, 10% or so. It's like, yeah, sure, that's a good. But then the mechanic of being able to like have reduced core costs or plus discipline or plus trade or so means that you can really like adapt your country in a short, quickly.
Right. Whatever's going on now. Yeah. You get to adapt to it. That makes sense. I like it. And you get to pick that every time you change your ruler, which can happen basically whenever you want as a republic. Yeah, well, every 4 years per yeah. merchant. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a little bit OP. Or not OP, but it's, yeah, probably the combination is a little bit stronger.
It's cool, but I can see what you're saying. On a standard setup in Europe, you are going to be completely isolated religiously.
Yeah, and then the Greek Wolf is another one of those that want to try crazy statues, created a, what was it? Shia Denmark. it's European countries basically blitzed him and destroyed him.
Yeah, you know, in a multiplayer setting, it would be interesting because more people might be tempted to change their religions a little bit, and you might not have the same sort of Catholic dominance.
Yeah, but this was in a multiplayer setting. The only problem was that there was like five people in Europe, and Europe's large. So the AI countries basically attacked those of because there was no other natural allies. Nobody wanted to ally with him early because none of the same religion and so on. So he has negative modifiers, which makes it kind of interesting.
Right. All right, I'm just having to manage my war here. Trying hard to take over some territory, but this is a lot more challenging, I feel like, than EU4. Maybe it's just because I'm used to it. Although France just offered me an alliance, so okay, now I'm fine.
the problem mostly with EU1 is that the interface is a little bit less understandable and less helpful.
Yeah, that's definitely true. You know, without knowing the game or having read the manual. Now, I do miss the fact that these games used to come with really, really good manuals, big, thick manuals. That's about as far as I've ever gotten to them back in the day, though. Is I would read the manuals over and over, and then I'd sit down to the game, and I still wouldn't have any luck. Hoi was the worst, like Hoi 1, 2.
Hoi 1's manual was, oh god, it was shit.
Is that the one that Fred wrote?
No, he wrote this. Fred wrote like 80% of the CK1 manual. The Hoxvian 1 manual was contracted out to someone. I don't want to mention his name because he's done a few games or so in the working community. But basically, he just read the design documents, original, didn't play test the games, and wrote the manual out of what the design document said. The only problem is that we hadn't updated the design document to what actually the game was about.
Oh.
So it was absolutely horrible manual.
Well, now, well, these days, you don't get enough manuals, but we have wikis now, which makes all the difference in the world. I tried to see if there was an EU1 wiki before going into here, and for some reason, there's not. And the game might be a little too old for that.
I still have like all these binders in at my office behind in a big drawer where there's like four binders of design document ideas and for EU1 basically, and all the interface layout designs drawn on paper.
Graph paper.
Kind of, yes.
There's so many interface elements though from here that I still see in the game. Like the dialogue boxes are basically the same. You've got your okay, your go to. I've got one up right now. Even the border, I mean, I don't think it's exactly the same, but it
No, but the
really
same
feels
style.
familiar.
It should be EU. You should r recognize the thread of from EU. And I think like when we did EU2, we started with a black and gold. EU1 is not so much black and gold.
Yeah, there's a little bit of gold trim around the windows, but that's about it. Yeah, the monarch points are still there. The trade. Well, no, the trade is pretty much the same as EU. That's another thing that took a big change in EU4, which I think was probably for the best because the merchant mechanic was kind of weird, in previous versions.
Yeah, it was
Trade's still not very simple, though. Like, that's one of the things I get the most questions about, and is also the one I'm least qualified to actually answer, is,
it's
you
it
know, how does trade work?
trade is very simple. You put merchants everywhere that leads towards your trade capital and have them transfer trade, all your merchants. Then you put as many lightships you have until you have like 75, 80% of the trade power in each node.
Yeah, it's a diminishing return, so at a certain point, like you're never gonna get to 100%, and that's
No.
okay.
I usually hover about when I have a large colonial empire, I'm satisfied with like 50, 60% everywhere because there's always someone else that drives trade forward anyway. So,
How often do you use privateers?
depends on your country. In pre-El Dorado, not really that much. El Dorado, if someone else has Aztecs and Inca gold and is in Europe, and I have a base in Caribbean, I do it a lot.
Yeah, see, I haven't actually played El Dorado properly. I mean, technically, I sat down at PDXCon for like an hour, but all I did is sit around designing nations because obviously that was super cool. And there was no way to get to that kind of mid game anyway. So, yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how the. So, that's all like the Spanish treasure fleet kind of mechanics, right? Now, how do they work? Do they you specifically send out a mission or.
No, basically, gold accumulates in colonial nations if they have gold producing provinces. And then when they reach 100%, which is a certain gold amount, or I can't remember the exact formula, but it's not too frequent, then it traces a route to your trade capital in your home continent. And at every trade node, basically you lo the privateers take a slice depending on how much privateer power there is. So
Okay.
basically you want to stick a lot of pirates in the Caribbean if you can.
Well, that, I mean, thematically, that's perfect. I think they even made a movie out of that.
And if you're Spain, you're basically looking at those progress bars, and when there's a year you're going when there's a year where you'll have a treasure fleet coming home, you might want to put your big ships out hunting the Caribbean because it might be worth it.
One of the changes in El Dorado that I like never saw coming and I'm weirdly excited for is just the ability to send out fleets as a as an exploration thing. Just because it's so incredibly tedious to explore around as is. I always like send my fleet somewhere and then forget about it and it dies to attrition. And I don't know what, so these little missions, which it never occurred to me, make sense. I mean, you're sending, you know, your people to scout out the Caribbean coast or this or that, and then they come home on their own and you don't have to really micromanage that aspect. And I thought that was a really nice change. I don't know who came up with that.
Yeah, it was mine. Let me actually check, because I'm 90% sure it was my idea and my design, but I can go into my Google Drive. But if people saw that one, they would hack me.
Well, you know, it's funny. Like, people are always, you know, talking about, like, I wonder if they're even thinking about, you know, game, whatever, you know, EU Rome 2 or Victoria 3 or this or that. And I'm like, and I always tell them, you know, they probably have 15 different designs for these games. And every person who works there probably has a bunch of different designs. And it would, like, it would be nice to take a look at those documents. But then, you know, 99% of it is never going to see anything.
There's a lot of design documents. It's like, I've done design documents on so many different games, everything from like a large MMO in the EU, what's it called, the EU series. It's actually a thing where we're talking to people like before. There was this huge finance crash in 2008, and people were not interested in investing anymore. It would have been an interesting aspect. Yeah, that was my design. It's like El Dorado, I designed it. It kind of works like this. Me and Viz designs, like, I design like 75-80% of the expansions for EU these days, and he comes up with a lot of stuff, and then we like discuss all the balance together, and he's in charge of actually developing the game. And Wiz was the one that made Nation Designer, but the mechanic stuff was my ideas, except for the Liberty Desire rework.
I can't remember if there's been an actual listing of what's in the DLC and what's in the patch. Is it going to be version 2 or is it going to be 1.10? I guess it's 1.10. Yeah.
Like, it's only 2 when we swap engines and stuff. Traitor Thurisillus is DLC, Colonial Nation Boast DLC, Pirate Hunting DLC, Free Advisor Packs DLC, Treasure Fleet DLC, Seven Cities DLC, Improved Naval Exploration System DLC, Inti DLC, Nahuatl DLC, Maya Religion DLC, Nation Designer DLC. Then we have like achievements is free. There's a few scripted stuff free. Liberty Desire rework free. Lots of dynamic historical events free.
All right. Well, we've been going for about an hour. So what I'm going to do is, I think I might let you go. We're going to take a break. Yeah. And when I come back, I might actually try my hand at playing a little bit more EU. But before we do that, I'm just wondering if anyone has a chance in the chat might have any few questions. Fortunately, the recording software and this build of EU1 don't seem to get along very well, which is often the case with the older games. Recording is really mean. It's all those custom assembly graphic subroutines.
Yeah.
So I'm just checking the chat here to see if there are any specific questions that we want to address, but then we'll go and take a bit of a break and I'll let you go. What time is it? I guess it's about 9 p.m. where you are.
Yeah, it's 9 p.m. and I'm after this one, I'm probably just going to wrap up and head to bed because I'm going up at 4:30 tomorrow morning so I can work for 8 hours.
What are people asking about? Ulster, the only nation in the world. Yeah, it's funny, the EU1 tutorial, you load it up and it's just like, it's all fog of war except for the one province of Ulster. Yeah. Everything else is dark. I'm like, you know, actually, there's something to be said about a tutorial like that that's just super hyper-focused on annoying anything else.
It's like, it's kind of like civilizations, you start with little, grow, etc.
Mm-hmm. Someone's asking me, I don't know what they mean. You ask Johan why base tax doesn't change in the EU4. Well, it does sometimes. There's events that change base tax of provinces.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if they mean grow over time, but every other system changes over time. Like, you get more production value or production efficiency and so on and so forth. So you do get more money as the game goes on, but
yeah,
I think it would be annoying if all the base numbers, like if you started at the base tax of 7 and by the end of it, everything was like a base tax of 35, the numbers just start getting a little bit ridiculous.
Yeah,
here's a good one. Judas Iscariot ask, what's the funnest part of developing an EU game? Or even maybe like an EU DLC, like what's the most enjoyable part of doing that?
Yeah, there's multiple parts. It's like, one, when you actually, it's like come up with the ideas and like discuss them and go like, yes, this is going to work out. Secondly, is that when you have a feature and you, I mean, I'm a programmer at heart. I'm a game developer at heart, and programming is a tool I use, but it's like when you actually have implemented it and it works and you feel like, yes, this is good work. And then when you actually see people enjoying it and saying like, oh, this is cool.
Yeah, when you get to create something and put it out in the world and people enjoy it, that feels good.
Yeah.
The release date for the EU4 DLC, El Dorado, that's been announced at this point, hasn't it? I think it's the 26th?
Yeah, next Thursday.
Yeah, so it's really close around the corner.
Yeah.
Now, I've been away. I've been traveling a whole bunch. Is there currently a El Dorado multiplayer game going on your on the Paradox channel?
We were actually been doing repeated nation designer streams, but someone may have broken the server compatibility with nation designer, so it didn't work today.
Oh, the observer mode is currently broken. That's funny.
Yeah. It's like, they have
no contact. Z Maj XD, I don't know what that name is, but is asking an interesting question. How do you come up with the achievements or even like the achievement names? Like, who designs those ideas? Because some of them are basic and some of them are ridiculous.
To be honest, for some of them, I actually look at the, there's a thread suggestions forum on our, that where people are writing about the ones they want to see, and sometimes I come up with them just for fun. It's like, do you want to hear two of them from the forums on I had?
Yeah, sure. Is this for El Dorado or?
Yeah, El Dorado.
Okay.
Some guy wrote this like, yeah, you should make an achievement for Hesse, and you know the Hessian mercenaries were a big part in the American War of Independence. But they were rented by the British, so they wanted to have like a reverse one, like if you play Hesse and have lots of mercenaries. So we made a Hessian mercenaries achievement for El Dorado, where you have, if you play Hesse, the small German state, and get at least 50 regiments of mercenaries. So that's one of those like where people have suggestions and we just take it. Then we have stuff we come up with that are because we're kind of crazy. And originally I had this long name for it, but then people said, this is too long and people are gonna get it. Because I had an original one, the name for this achievement was, this is not madness, this is Persia. But people said, no, you should just name it, this is Persia. And it was form Persia and conquer Egypt, Anatolia, and Greece.
Right. Yeah, this is Persia, yeah.
So it's kind of like, sometimes it's like word puns, sometimes it's stuff that fits, or sometimes it's like references. We made there's a Swedish song by an artist called Timbuktu, which is versus things like, no, everyone wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. And there's this achievement in EU4 where you have to conquer Timbuktu, as Songhai. And it's like, it's called Nobody Wants to Die.
How many musical references do you have in those achievements?
There's the Mercury one. For you know, the Freddie Mercury reference, Queen of Mercury, because if you have the town he was born in and the town he grew up in, you get the achievement.
Really? Yeah, I haven't looked at the achievements that much, just because when I record, if, you know, something happens with my recording, like it doesn't go properly, yeah, which happens all the time, then I have to, like, you know, just restart. So I don't tend to play Iron Man, so I don't personally look at the achievements too much. So I'm always surprised when someone shows me, like, an interesting one. I'm like, oh my God. And how it's involved in like making them, because you must have to put in hooks all over the place in the program to track some new piece of data for some achievement, like active mercenary count.
It's not that hard, because if we expose triggers like that, then it's the modders like it. So, but
all right.
We really like doing stuff like pop culture references, like the princess is in this castle, and like seriously, over 9,000.
Yeah, well, you have to have that one. That can't be helped.
Yeah.
Pie Eater is asking, "What's your favorite nation to play?" Now I'm gonna guess some sort of step horde.
Not really. Actually, I like playing Poland.
Oh, so strong.
It's like Poland is fun because you can fight wars, and I like fighting wars. Mm-hmm. But I'd say Poland is probably my favorite EU country.
They're right in the middle of the action. There's a lot of early targets. They can decide to go east or west and get a very, very different feeling, or south even, I suppose.
Yeah. Sadly, that lots of my coworkers have voted to nerf Polish ideas after quite a lot of... They used to be a lot better.
They are pretty strong. And I mean, the AI is sort of always plays a very consistent and middle ground kind of Poland, but in the player's hand, well, I guess any nation in the player's hand is pretty brutal. Oh, I have a question for you. Why doesn't Scandinavia have any events? So you're playing as Sweden, you've got all these cool events that can trigger, but if you become Scandinavia, nothing.
No, because why would you want to change your beautiful flag?
Well, that is a good point. But there's a really good reason why, as Sweden, you'd want to change your flag. Because it looks exactly the same as France's flag when you're zoomed out. All I see is, like, blue with three little thingies on it. I'm like, oh my God, France is coming. Oh, no, wait, it's me.
Yeah. Well, I think, like, if you're playing a country that borders Sweden and France, you don't really care which one is attacking you, because either one's coming with 40k of insane soldiers, or you get 25k of super insane soldiers.
Yeah, all those Swedish ideas and events that come in and like plus 10% morale. I'm like, oh no. Yeah.
That's like Swedish ideas. Sweden, Spain, Portugal have had their national, the historical ideas severely, and Turkey as well for El Dorado. Severely overhauled and balanced and updated.
I remember with the Ottomans, with the what was it called, the Gaza buff that would triple their manpower, or Gaza when they were at war,
it was so exploitable.
Yeah, it's definitely more balanced now. But I mean, that's the sort of thing that will keep happening because people keep finding little edge cases and abuses in this set. The HRE is something else that I feel has been sort of had to be nerfed and fixed quite a few times. And it might be nice to get a little bit of an overhaul, not just like a little adjustment and nerfing at some point, but a bit of another look at some point. Because I think the HRE is a place that has potential for a lot of fun. But right now, other than a little bit of manipulating sort of relationship with some of the electors, there's not a ton to do. And no. I mean, I realize it's not CK2, but it feels like there could be a lot more politicking going on there.
There's so much stuff in HRE that can be done, but there's also the balancing issues. Mm-hmm. It's such a danger that entire system.
Yeah, because it can very easily become overpowered right away, especially in the hands of a player. Like, boom, now I have a Germany and no one can do anything about it.
Yeah, that's true. And,
Well, all right, I think I'm going to go ahead and put in a cut here. We'll take a break.
Yeah, cool.
We've been talking about nonstop for an hour, so.
Yeah, cool. Have a nice evening or afternoon or whatever it's in Canada now.
Mm-hmm.
And, well, yeah, sorry.
No, that's good. I was going to say, yeah, and you have a good night too. Hopefully the weather's not too bad over there. It's still pretty frosty over here.
It's about freezing here, so that's cool.
Yeah, last night it was minus 45 Celsius when you counted in the wind chill factor.
Holy schmoly.
Yeah. It's
like, here it's like a few degrees below when it's not windy, but it's just a little bit cold.
Now, there's frost on the inside of my door here. So yeah. I miss the weather in Sweden already. And the food.
Oh, yeah. I like the food we had in the bunker. It's like old classic military slop.
Yeah, well, it was the simplest meal, I think, of the whole thing. And I honestly think people enjoyed it the most, just that beef stew. We're going to make everyone jealous now and hungry.
Yeah. Take care, mate.
Thank you very much. See you later.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
And to everyone that's still watching, we're going to take a short break here. And we'll be right back.